So before we begin, look at this text, which is taken from the second chapter of Meanings in Contemporary Realism, The Ideology of Modernism. Before we look at that text, let us briefly talk about the background when Lukács was writing. You all know that he was a Marxist critic. He is a Hungarian, and he was very influential during our youth, that is, in the even in the 60s and in the 70s, he was very popular in Bengal particularly. And at that time we read some of his works, but of course we didn't have the money to buy books. So today I don't have many of his books. I recently bought one of his books, The Destruction of Reason, which is a very thick tome, and I have not yet started reading it. But his writings on modernism I read earlier also, and they were actually very popular among the youth of Bengal. He belongs to the Stalinist era, and he was for a short period a member of the ministry, but then there was a coup, and all members of that ministry, they were either exiled or executed. Lukács narrowly was saved. He was exiled to Romania. He was not executed. So later he joined again with the Communist Party, and his sympathies were always with the Communist Party. He was a member, an active member. But in his youth, the philosophy which was very influential, that was Neo-Kantianism. And since Lukács was interested in aesthetics, so you may imagine that Kant's or Neo-Kantian theories of aesthetics were also influential upon him. He has a strange relationship with the other famous Marxist theoreticians or aestheticians of his time, like Theodor Adorno, the German aesthetician. He sometimes quotes with approval Walter Benjamin, but he was very critical of Adorno, and he made a kind of a niche theory of his own based on dialectical materialism, on aesthetics. The principal approach of Lukács vis-à-vis modernist literature is that he was in favor of some modernists, whereas against others. Particularly, we may say that there is a famous writing by him, Mann or Kafka. So he opposed Kafka against Mann, and he was in favor of Thomas Mann rather than Franz Kafka. And we will see, particularly from this essay, we will understand what his approach was towards modernist novels. He also wrote on the theory of the novel. Now, about Stalin, he did not, or could not, we may say, openly criticize Stalin, but he was not a supporter of Stalin's theories, and he was against, actually, Stalinist theory and later he would criticize Stalin. But that was not possible so earlier. So for a long time he remained within the Communist Party of Hungary, and he remained a sympathizer of the Russian Communist Party, but he did not criticize Stalin. He was a supporter of Leninism. So we may say that he can be considered as one of the revisionists of Orthodox Marxism. For Lukács, ideology is a projection of the class consciousness of the bourgeoisie, which functions to prevent the proletarian from attaining consciousness of its revolutionary position. So at the beginning of our essay, we will see that Lukács speaks about ideology and says that I am defining ideology in a particular sense here, referring to literature and not to ideology in the philosophical sense. So what was ideology in the philosophical sense? That was of course based upon the writings of Marx and Engels on German ideology. So Lukács understood ideology as projection of the class consciousness of the bourgeoisie that tried to prevent the proletariat from becoming conscious of its revolutionary power and position. Therefore, since literature and the arts, they are also in a way parts of ideology, therefore willingly they have to kind of be complicit with the ideology of the times, the bourgeois ideology of the times. So writers like Franz Kafka, who was against the Nazi ideology, could not openly criticize that ideology, and therefore some indirect approach towards ideology, towards the philosophical and ideological position can be found in writers like Kafka. So Lukács points out the difficulties of a writer like Kafka, and how far modernist ideology is complicit with bourgeois political thought. That was a question raised by the Stalinists, and Lukács does not have a blind orthodox Stalinist view, say regarding Joyce and other modernist writers. But we will see that he is not even extremely open towards Joyce. So he has some criticism, some dislike of some of the modernistic developments in literature. Lukács was influenced by the sociologists like Max Weber and Georg Simmel, and of course Marx's Capital and Hegel's concept of appearance. He developed the ideas of reification and commodity fetishism. So these are important theoretical concepts developed by him. The theory of the novel is a seminal work in literary theory as well as theory of genre. It is a history of the novel as a form and an investigation into its distinct characteristics. And Lukács maintains that the novel is the necessary epic form of our time. Now, when a writer like Lukács speaks about novel, you may understand that his idea of novel is based upon, naturally would be based upon bourgeois realistic novels, the novels of Balzac and other Tolstoy and other writers. He has a book called The Historical Novel. In it he traces the development of the genre of historical fiction. While prior to 1789, he argues, people's consciousness of history was relatively underdeveloped. The French Revolution and Napoleonic Wars that followed brought about a realization of the constantly changing, evolving character of human existence. This new historical consciousness was reflected in the work of Sir Walter Scott, whose novels use representative or typical characters to dramatize major social conflicts and historical transformations. For example, the dissolution of feudal society in the Scottish Highlands and the entrenchment of mercantile capitalism. So you may realize how much Lukács's books, his theoretical books, influenced Marxist literary criticism. Lukács argues that Scott's new brand of historical realism was taken up by Balzac and Tolstoy and enabled novelists to depict contemporary social life not as a static drama of fixed universal types, but rather as a moment of history constantly changing, open to the potential of revolutionary transformation. For this reason, he sees these authors as progressive and their work as potentially radical, despite their own personal conservative politics. So you see that we have kind of strange situation where the Marxist critic favors the older novelists over the modernist novelists, and even suggests that older novelists like Scott, they were Scott, Balzac, Tolstoy, they were more progressive than the modernist novelists like James Joyce and others. So we may say that Lukács's approach towards modernism is somewhat influenced by his political analysis, and he never mentions Ezra Pound or T.S. Eliot in his study of modernism. But Lukács, the historical realist tradition began to give way after 1848 revolutions, when the bourgeoisie ceased to be a progressive force and their role as agents of history was usurped by the proletariat. After this time, historical realism begins to sicken and lose its concern with social life as inescapably historical. So why is this emphasis upon history in Lukács' analysis? Because historical materialism was a very important train of thought among the Marxists of his time. He illustrates this point by comparing Flaubert's historical novel Salammbô to that of the earlier realists. For him, Flaubert's work marks a turning away from relevant social issues and an elevation of style over substance. While he does not discuss Sentimental Education, a novel much more overtly concerned with recent historical developments, is not clear. For much of his life, Lukács promoted a return to the realist tradition that he believed it had reached its height with Balzac and Scott, and bemoaned the supposed neglect of history that characterized modernism. So, from this analysis, I suppose we have got the gist of Lukács's theoretical approach. He laments the passing away of the great age of bourgeois realism in novels, which were basically dependent upon historical approach to reality. And the experimentations of the modernist poets and writers, particularly regarding style, were disliked by him. And that is why, beginning from Flaubert, because Flaubert is the master of stylistic development, and novelists like James Joyce and many modernist novelists, they all learn from Flaubert, and that is why we see that Lukács dislikes this elevation of style over historical content. He wrote an essay in 1938 called Realism in the Balance. So I am only reading from one of the notes on Lukács that I have sent you. So Realism in the Balance, written in 1938, written while he lived in Soviet Russia and first published in a German literary journal, in which he defends the traditional realism of authors like Thomas Mann in the face of rising modernist movements such as Expressionism, Surrealism and Naturalism. Practitioners of these movements, such as James Joyce, placed an emphasis on displaying the discord and disenchantment of modern life through techniques that highlight individualism and individual consciousness, such as stream of consciousness. Now, what is wrong if an author focuses on individual consciousness? Of course, that goes against the communist notion that there should be class consciousness over and above everything rather than individual consciousness. In his essay, Lukács presents a complex nuanced view of these movements and their relation to what he regards as true realism. On the one hand, Lukács argues that such movements are a historical necessity, but he also strongly expresses the sentiment that these new artistic movements lack what he views as revolutionary power. So because he writes from the dialectical point of view of historical materialism, therefore he cannot deny that these artistic movements were results of historical facts. Because you know that the Marxist dialectical materialism believes that all historical facts can be explained by analyzing the dynamics of thesis and antithesis. Lukács accepts these movements as historical necessity, that is, they could not have been avoided. But he thinks that they are not revolutionary. Lukács sets up a dialectical opposition between two elements he believes inherent to human experience. He maintains that this dialectical relation exists between the appearance of events as subjective, unfettered experiences and their essence as provoked by the objective totality of capitalism. So, where does he get this theory of appearance? From Hegel, of course. So he says that to individual subjects, history or events appear in a subjective way, and from the point of view of dialectical materialism, the unfettered experiences and their essence are provoked by the objective totality of capitalism. Lukács explains that good realists such as Thomas Mann create a contrast between the consciousnesses of their characters, which are appearances, and a reality independent of them, essence. The individual consciousnesses, they are understood as appearances, philosophically. They are as events appear to one individual's consciousness, or a few individuals' consciousness, to which is opposed the historical essence that is independent of their appearance in the subjective consciousness of people. Appearance of reality in subjective consciousnesses, a reality independent of this appearance, which is essence. So you may well understand that Lucas is applying Marxist theory and is falling back upon an essentialism. And this is where, you remember, Sartre differed with Marxism, because according to existentialism, existence precedes essence. And where did Sartre get that idea? From Heidegger. And to a Marxist critic like Lukács, Heidegger is a damned bourgeois philosopher, an idealist philosopher. So these are the conflicts that we see in Lukács's writings. Let us look at his text. Let me copy your attendance or I will forget it. So, The Ideology of Modernism is the second chapter of his book Meanings in Contemporary Realism. And you can see that I have made these notes here. That is why I am forcing you to read this version, even though this scan is not very clean. I have a very clean copy of the whole book of the Meanings in Contemporary Realism, which I will give you later. It is no way surprising that the most influential contemporary school of writing should still be committed to the dogmas of modernist anti-realism. So, the first sentence mentions modernist writing as anti-realist. I suppose Lukács had previously written on this subject also, and that is why he expects people to understand what he means by anti-realism or what is realism. That must be explained in the first chapter, in the second chapter. So we understand that Lukács looks at modernistic writings as anti-realist, and the use of the word dogma also suggests that this is some kind of an ideology, kind of blind practice. It is here that we must begin our investigation if we are to chart the possibilities of a bourgeois realism. What does he mean by possibilities of a bourgeois realism? Was not bourgeois realism acceptable as a theory to everybody by the time he was writing? Yes, it was, but he was the greatest writer from a Marxist point of view on bourgeois realism. Therefore, we may say that through these writings, he is laying bare the structure of bourgeois realism in literature. We must compare the two main trends in contemporary bourgeois literature and look at the answers to the two major ideological and artistic questions about that. He divides modernistic writings into two trends. So, as I told you, that the questions were based on such oppositions as whether Mann or Kafka, which novelist should be more appreciated. So Mann and Kafka represented the two different trends. And what are these two trends? Lukács is explaining that in this essay. So remember, the title of this essay is The Ideology of Modernism, which means that modernism is an aesthetic movement, but there is an implicit ideology behind this movement. Ideology means that which a particular class projects as its reality or truth. So ideology, according to Marxist analysis, is always false. and the belief, faith, culture of any class is projected through its products like literature, arts, different forms of art, film, everything. So all cultural products. So they carry the stamp of the ideology of that particular class, which if it is the bourgeois class, let us say, it tries to impose upon everybody else. So that this ideology appears to be the only truth, even though it is false. In other words, ideology is an attempt at hoodwinking people by making a particular kind of belief or culture appear as the only truth. So ideology is always class oriented, it always has a political motive behind it. There is a book by Terry Luton on ideology, which is very helpful. If you want, you can read that. So here Lukács's attempt is to expose the ideology which is behind modernism or modernistic art. So ideology is always underlined. It has to be exposed. We shall concentrate on the underlying ideological basis of these trends, ideological in the above defined, not in the strictly philosophical sense. So how is it defined above? That Lukács is going to talk about the dogmas of modernist anti-realism and not talk about ideology in the philosophical sense that we discussed a little earlier. That an attempt to impose a particular philosophical understanding of reality to others with a political motive. Which means that Lukács says here that I am not going to discuss literature or novels here always in terms of philosophical analysis, but a little I limit my discussion to literature and arts. I do not constantly go back to philosophy. That is his intention here. What must be avoided at all cost? What must be avoided at all costs is the approach generally adopted by bourgeois modernist critics themselves. So Lukács is a Marxist critic and he opposes himself to the bourgeois critics. That exaggerated concern with formal criteria, with questions of style and literary technique. So according to Lukács, the artists, the modernists, they exaggerate form over content. So as you know that there is a dialectical relationship between form and content. And here again there is this debate whether form determines content or content determines form. And this debate can be found among the formalist critics like Viktor Stovsky. I am writing on the chat box. I hope that this spelling is correct. In any case, it is a Russian name. So Stovsky was a noted formalist critic. the Russian formalist critics, they depended upon linguistics. They developed their theories based upon linguistics. There is a book by Tony Bennett called Marxism and Formalism. Formalist critics are very significant in their contributions. So, according to Lukács, the modernist writers, they exaggerate form and the question of style and technique. According to Aristotle, the relationship between content and form is interdependent. So, content developed form, form also developed content. So Aristotle did not look at content and form as oppositions like the Marxists do. So the Marxists always want to emphasize on content and the formalists want to emphasize on form. So somewhere between Aristotle and today we have lost this, you know, harmonious understanding of the harmonious relationship between form and content. To take an example, the monologue Atherier, compare for instance Bloom's monologue in the laboratory or Molly's monologue in Beck at the beginning and at the end of Ulysses. Now somebody wrote about this essay by Lukács, that Lukács does not pay enough attention to Joyce in this essay. But that is not entirely true, because we see that the first example he gives is from James Joyce and his novel Ulysses, which you all know was a monumental work, a path-breaking work which defined the 20th century in novel. And there are such interior monologues in this novel. Lukács cites two examples, one at the beginning, another at the end. And he compares them to another monologue in Thomas Mann's novel, Lottie in Weimar. In that novel, Mann makes Goethe a character in his novel who is delivering an early morning monologue. So the stylistic technique is the same. Plainly, the same stylistic technique is being employed. And certain of Thomas Mann's remarks about Joyce and his methods would appear to confirm this. So Mann also learned from James Joyce. But he does not use interior monologue in the same way as that of Joyce. So there lies a difference. The underlying principles behind Joyce and Mann, Mann's interior monologue are the same, even though they appear to be stylistically different. So, where do you place the emphasis? Do you place the emphasis on the stylistic difference, as Lukács does, or do you place the emphasis on the sameness of the stylistic technique? So my comment here emphasizes on the sameness of the stylistic technique. Lukács, on the other hand, emphasizes on the difference. It is not easy to think of any two novels more basically dissimilar than Ulysses and Lottie in Weimar. This is true even of the superficially rather similar. It is true even of the superficially similar scenes. I am not referring to the striking difference in intellectual quality. I refer to the fact. With Joyce, the stream of consciousness technique is no more stylistic device. It is itself the formative principle governing the narrative pattern and the presentation of character. So, Lukács makes the point here that stream of consciousness in Joyce is not only a technique. It has an underlying attitude, approach, philosophy, whatever we might say, an underlying principle. It is the formative principle governing the narrative pattern and presentation of character. Technique here is something absolute. It is part and parcel of the aesthetic ambition informing Ulysses. So, the technique becomes absolute in Joyce's case, the stream of consciousness technique. And it informs the whole approach of the novel and Joyce's aesthetic ambition. What does he want to achieve aesthetically in this novel? That is informed by this particular technique of stream of consciousness. With Mann, on the other hand, the monologue anterior is simply a technical device allowing the author to explore aspects of Goethe's world which would not have been otherwise available. Goethe's experience is not presented as confined to momentary sense impressions. The artist reaches down to the core of Goethe's personality, to the complexity of his relations with his own past, present and even future experience. This is the difference. With Joyce it is a formative principle, with Mann interior monologue is a device. So Mann wants to explore various aspects of Goethe's world and not limit his work to only sense impressions of the character. So he reaches down to the personality, complexity of relations, to past, present and future experiences. The stream of association is only apparently free. The monologue is composed with the utmost artistic rigor. It is a carefully plotted sequence gradually piercing to the core of Goethe's personality. So Lukács means to say that Thomas Mann finds this stream of consciousness technique extremely helpful in exploring the psyche of a character. Every person or event emerging momentarily from the stream and vanishing again is given a specific weight, a definite position in the pattern of the whole. However unconventional the presentation, the compositional principle is that of the traditional epic. Notice that Lukács uses the word epic because he considers novel to be the modern epic. And what does epic stand for? It stands for a narration of events. So in the traditional epic we find narration of events and a composition. The same thing can be found in Thomas Mann's essay, where stream of consciousness technique never becomes the overbearing principle. It is only a technique used to perform a particular role in order to flesh out the narration and compose a pattern into it. In the way the pace is controlled and the transitions and climaxes are organized, the ancient rules of epic narration are faithfully observed. Pace, that is the speed, the tempo of events, transitions, climaxes and so on. So the rules of narration in Thomas Mann are traditional. It would be absurd, in view of Joyce's artistic ambitions and his manifest abilities, to qualify the exaggerated attention he gives to the detailed recording of sense data and his comparative neglect of ideas and emotions as artistic failure. So Lukács is not a Marxist critic who is orthodox and therefore loses the nuances. So Lukács is attentive and examines Joyce's technique and says that Joyce gives exaggerated attention to detailed recording of sense data. So you remember A Portrait of the Artist or any other novel by Joyce. So what is the purpose of the realistic descriptions where so many sense data are given in details, which Lucas thinks leads to a neglect of ideas and emotions? In which sense is Joyce's novel a neglect of ideas and emotions? It is unlike conventional bourgeois novelists. Joyce does not tell us a story of emotions of various characters. He may focus on one character, like in A Portrait, the character of Stephen, and his emotions are visible, but even then, sense data is overwhelming. So the lack of, or the neglect of ideas and emotions is not an artistic failure in Joyce. All this was in conformity with Joyce's artistic intentions. And by use of such techniques, he may be said to have achieved them satisfactorily. So Lucas suggests that every author has some artistic intention or aesthetic ambition. What he wants to achieve in a particular work. So Joyce did not want to write a novel like Balzac or even Flaubert. So that was not his aesthetic ambition. So his technique is appropriate for his aesthetic ambition. Between Joyce's intentions and those of Thomas Mann, there is a total opposition. Now, whether this opposition that Lucas suggests can be called total, whether that is true or not, that will have to look at separately. But we see that for Lucas, Joyce and Mann, even though both of them are modernist writers, their aesthetic ambitions are different. And that is why there is an opposition in their intention. The perpetually oscillating pattern of sense and memory data, their powerfully charged but aimless and directionless fields of force, give rise to an epic structure which is static, reflecting a belief in the basically static character of humans. This is criticism of Joyce's work. According to Lucas, the representation of sense data, memory data, and the powerful emotions represented through memory, they appear to be aimless and directionless. And therefore, the epic structure which is created in Joyce's novel, that is static. And that reflects a belief in the static character of events. Now, this is definitely a damning comment. Because as we know that the Marxists, they believe that history is dynamic because of the operation of dialectic. There are always oppositions of thesis and antithesis which lead to a new synthesis. But if in the artistic work we find that the structure that is created is static, and if Lucas here comments that it reflects that Joyce does not believe in the dynamic character of events, but he thinks that events are static. So opposed to this belief, there is the belief that events are dynamic, and Lucas finds that belief in Thomas Mann. The these opposed views of the world, dynamic and development on the one hand, static and sensational on the other. This should be modified. The epic structure, let me see if I can modify it here. No, I cannot. The epic structure in Joyce is static. And Lucas says that there are therefore these two attitudes or two approaches. In Joyce it is static and sensational, and in Mann it is dynamic and developmental. So sensational does not mean sensational in the ordinary use of the term, but representation of the senses, sense data, in that sense sensation. So this distinction, these distinctions are of crucial importance. So these two, Lucas conceives these two as two different worldviews. In examining the two schools of literature I have mentioned, I shall return to the opposition later. Here I want to only point out that an exclusive emphasis on formal matters can lead to serious misunderstanding of the character of an artist's work. So this sentence is probably for a critic. That is, a critic should not look only on form in a writer, because that will lead to misunderstanding. For example, if one looks at the form of Thomas Mann, then one would see that Mann uses the interior monologue like Joyce. But one won't understand that his approach to writing novel is dynamic and developmental, and so on. What determines the style of a given work of art? How does the intention determine the form? We are concerned here, of course, with the intention realized in the work. It may not coincide with the writer's conscious intention. So, because a critic can only judge the work of art as it has been produced, and not what the writer wanted to do, but what he ultimately achieved. So what is behind the decision of an author regarding style? The distinctions that concern us are not those between stylistic techniques in the formalistic sense. So Lucas wants to make it clear that he is not writing a formalist criticism. It is the view of the world, the ideology of Weltanschauung underlying a writer's work, that counts. Now, Weltanschauung was a picture, but actually I think this term is taken from Hegel. Welt means world, Anschauung, it is appearance or picture. So the world picture or approach to the world, attitude to the world, that is the view of the world. And it is the writer's attempt to reproduce this view of the world which constitutes his intention and is the formative principle underlying the style of a given piece of writing. Alright, so at the beginning of the paragraph, Lucas asks, what determines style of a work of art? And at the end, he answers that the writer's view of the world or Weltanschauung or ideology determines the form or technique of a work of art. Looked at in this way, style ceases to be a formalistic category. Rather, it is rooted in content. It is the specific form of a specific content. So here, by this analysis, Lucas attempts to establish that to look at style only as a formal aspect, as the formalists do, is wrong, because style is largely determined by content since it is decided by the ideology of the writer or worldview of the writer, therefore it is influenced by the content. It is the specific form of a specific content. So style is not a formalistic category but is rooted in content. Marxist analysis, this is a Marxist analysis, content determines form. So Lucas takes his position on this debate between whether content determines form or form determines content. He takes his position as a Marxist writer that content determines form by arguing that the writer's worldview, ideological approach, determines the style of his work. So he does not keep anything ambiguous. Content determines form. Why does he mention things so clearly? Because as a Marxist critic, he wants to be understood very clearly by everyone. Compared to today's theoreticians, say post-structuralist, post-modernist theoreticians, where you will find that you do not understand most of the things that they are saying, because they shroud their content in such ambiguous and complex sentences. You find in Lucas very easy sentences. Can you imagine a more simple sentence than this one? Subject, verb, object, content determines form. But there is no content of which man himself is not the focal point. However, various the domain of literature, a particular experience, a didactic purpose, the basic question is and will remain, what is man? Domain means what is given, the subject matter chosen by the author. So whatever subject matter the author has chosen, ultimately it has to do something with man. So the work raises the question, what is man? What should we say about this? How do we comment on this? Clearly, we may say that Lucas has a humanistic point of view, a modern humanist, of course, not a Renaissance humanist, but the idea that man is supreme, so everything is for man, literature or art is also for man. So any work raises this question, what is man? And there is a point of division. If you put the question in abstract philosophical terms, leaving aside all formal considerations, you arrive for the real school at the traditional Aristotelian dictum, which was also reached by other than purely aesthetic considerations. So Lucas associates bourgeois realism with Aristotelian mimesis. Here he reaches this decision that the realist school follows the Aristotelian dictum from a formal consideration. But he argues that this decision has been reached also from non-aesthetic considerations. What is the decision? That bourgeois realism follows Aristotelian mimesis. So he gives here the Aristotelian answer to what is man, which is, we all know, is very different from Platonic or Neoplatonic answer. Man is zoon politikon, a social animal. Now this definition of man leaves out a lot of things about man. It actually leaves out his entire spiritual or idealistic thought, because it is a zoological point of view. when you look at man as an animal, the Darwinists will be very happy with this Aristotelian definition of man, an animal who is also social. So, politikon means social, therefore the political aspects of man's being are important. Zoon, therefore animal, so the zoological aspects of man are important. But what about other aspects of man? All the high-flown idealistic philosophy of the Platonists, they are thrown into the dustbin by this Aristotelian definition. The Aristotelian dictum is applicable to all great realistic literature. Lukács, of course, believes in this Aristotelian definition because he is a Marxist. So he says that all realistic literature follows this Aristotelian dictum. Achilles and Werther, Oedipus and Tom Jones, Antigone and Anna Karenina, their individual existence, their sein und Wesen in the Hegelian terminology, their ontological being, as a more fashionable terminology has it, cannot be distinguished from their social and historical environment. So in bourgeois realistic literature, by which Lukács means the great bourgeois novelists of the 19th century, so there, of course, Lukács also refers to Greek literature, but basically Werther is Goethe, Sorrows of Young Werther, Goethe's early novel, Tom Jones by Fielding, Anna Karenina Tolstoy. You all recognize this, but Achilles, Oedipus and Antigone. So in one sentence, Lukács brings together Greek writers as well as 19th century or earlier writers, 18th century writers, and say that they all belong to realistic literature. All great realistic literature present man or man's being in itself. Now you see this Hegelian being in itself is the early crude definition of being, which later Heidegger developed, and Sartre takes his concept of being in itself from Heidegger, not from Hegel. But Lukács takes his concept of being in itself from Hegel. So he is still depending upon idealistic philosophers, because Hegel is idealistic, and says that their ontological being here, probably he is alluding to Heidegger's use of this term, and says that it cannot be distinguished from social and historical environment. So for realistic literature, man's being is essentially social and historical. Their human significance, their specific individuality cannot be separated from the context in which they were created. So why does Lukács refer to the social historical reality of characters in a novel, in a work of art? Because he is going to oppose this kind of realistic writing to modernistic writing, where style, technique become more important than social, historical environment. To some extent, this analysis is self-defeating, particularly insofar as he refers to James Joyce, as I think somebody commented. I will later refer you to the critical writings. Somebody commented that Joyce neglects the representation of social political reality. Lucas neglects the representation of social political reality in James Joyce's writings because he is bent upon establishing this opposition between modernists like Joyce and Kafka and modernists like Thomas Mann. So he robs Joyce of all historical social content. If you have any question, you can ask me.
Sir.
Yes.
Hello. Sir, am I audible?
Yes.
Sir, I was just wanting to ask you, I think I lost connection in the last portion that you were talking about social and historical.
Yes.
Sir, just can you repeat that portion?
Yes, sure.
Thank you.
Yes, so this paragraph, you see, contains the kernel of Lukács' argument. Lukács draws a line from the Greek writers Sophocles, because he refers to Antigone, Oedipus, from the Greek writers through the 19th century novelists like Balzac, Tolstoy, and then on 18th century like Fielding, and then on to 20th century realistic writers like Thomas Mann. So even though Thomas Mann is modernist, according to Lukács, the realistic tradition prevails in him. And his argument here is that all these writers, they follow Aristotle's dictum that man is a social animal. And that is why they represent man in his social, historical, political context in their works. Now, you all know that Marxist critics, they always analyze any particular author or artist according to the socio-political context. So Lukács does the same, but he draws a distinction between two kinds of writers: those who follow emphasize the socio-political context, according to Lukács, they are following Aristotle. They are realists. Why I wrote in my comment that they follow Aristotelian mimesis? Because Aristotle suggested in his theory of mimesis that reality is represented or reflected as in a mirror in a work of art. You know that this theory, this reflectionist theory, is very different from Plato's idea of mimesis. You know that Plato spoke about the truth being in the idea, not in the object. The object is a mimesis, an imitation of the idea. But Aristotle denies any such, you know, truth, and that is not in the object, and says that the object itself is the truth, and it should be represented in a work of literature like the reflection in a mirror. So here we find a definition of realism which is partial, one may say, and which is based upon Aristotelian mimesis and his theory, his definition of man as a social animal. But as I told you, is this definition all-inclusive? Is man only a social animal and nothing else? So this whole definition, this definition leaves out a lot of human experience, much of his mental, spiritual experiences that are not covered by emphasizing upon his social reality or his biological reality. Therefore, we must say that Lukács' definition of realism here is a little narrow. So Lukács refers to Hegel's idea of being in itself and kind of taunts Heidegger by calling it a fashionable terminology. So he does not mention Heidegger by name, but obviously when he is using the phrase ontological being, he is alluding to Heidegger and says it is more of a fashionable statement. Actually, Hegelian Sein und Sich was sufficient enough, according to, that is apparent here. So, he says that it cannot be distinguished from their social historical environment. Their human significance, their specific individuality cannot be separated from the context in which they were created. We see here an emphasis upon the context, and it is assumed that the humanity of man or a character, the individuality of a character, these are also intimately tied to the socio-historical context, according to Lukács. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
The ontological view governing the image of man in the work of leading modernist writers is the exact opposite of this. So now you see, Lukács starts using the expression ontological. It appears to be more fashionable to him. But the ontological view governing the image of man in the work of leading modernist writers is the exact opposite of this. Man, for these writers, is by nature solitary, asocial, unable to enter into relationship with other human beings. So here he is referring to the writers who write in a different tradition. The modernist writers who do not exactly follow the realistic tradition that he mentioned in the previous paragraph. So these leading modernist writers, they are opposed to the image of man in the realistic idea. So modernism is opposed to this ultra realism. And Thomas Wolfe once wrote, "My view of the world is based on the firm conviction that solitariness is by no means a rare condition, something peculiar to myself, or to especially solitary human beings, but the inescapable central fact of human existence." The notion or the idea that man is by nature solitary, asocial, unable to enter into relationship with other human beings, these ideas can be found in the leading modernist writers like Joyce and Kafka. Man thus imagined may establish contact with other individuals, but only in a superficial, accidental manner, only ontologically speaking, by retrospective reflection. So, this loneliness, solitariness, or inability to form relationship with others, this has a name. The name is alienation. So modernist writers give expression to this alienation in man. Now, there are historical reasons why such notions of alienation, fragmentation have found expression in writing and in art. The catastrophic experiences of the two world wars, the Cold War, the opposition between two blocs, the bitter fight between Marxists in the political sense, not in the philosophical sense, Marxist and Kudra political views of the different states. All these were not experienced by the earlier writers that Lucas mentions as realists, let alone the Greek writers, even writers like Fielding or Tolstoy. They did not experience this, Balzac. So there are reasons, historical reasons, why man has felt this alienation, fragmentation of his being that finds expression in modernistic writing. But Lukács kind of ignores that quality of modernist literature and thinks that it is a negative way of looking at things. Man is may establish contact with other individuals, but in a superficial, accidental manner. So the strength of human relationships seems to have evaporated. This basic solitariness of man must not be confused with that individual solitariness to be found in the literature of traditional realism. In the latter case, we are dealing with a particular situation in which a human being may be placed due either to his character or to the circumstance of his life. So, solitariness was represented in earlier realistic literature also. But Lukács says that we should not confuse the modernist solitariness with the solitariness in earlier literature, where an individual finds himself or herself solitary for particular circumstances. It may be, solitariness may be objectively conditioned, as with Sophocles' Philoctetes put ashore on the bleak island of Lemnos, or it may be subjective, the product of inner necessity, as with Tolstoy's Ivan Illich or Proverbs Frederick Moreau in the Education of something of that. But it is always merely a fragment. So this reminds me that a critic wrote that, or we read it today from the note on Georgi Lukács, that Lukács does not speak much about Flaubert's Education Sentimental. He does speak of it, but he does not elaborate upon it. But it is always merely a fragment, a phase, a climax or anticlimax in the life of the community as a whole. Which means that the solitariness represented in Sophocles, Flaubert, this solitariness, or Tolstoy, this solitariness has a social historical context. It represents some kind of condition of the community as a whole. The fate of such individuals is characteristic of certain human types in specific social or historical circumstances. Besides and beyond their solitariness, the common life, the strife and togetherness of other human beings goes on as before. So solitariness of one or two characters does not disturb the community life of people. In 19th century realist writers, unlike modernists. Beside and beyond, in a word, their solitariness is a specific social fate, not a universal condition of human. Condition of human, this is the title of André Malraux's novel, published in 1993. The human condition. So, unlike André Malraux, who represents the whole condition, human condition, as being bereft of communal life, as being solitary and sad, that is not to be found in Flaubert or Tolstoy. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. The latter, of course, characteristic of the theory and practice of modernism, that is, where solitariness is a social and not the circumstances of an individual's life. So that is characteristic of the theory and practice of modernism. I would like in the present time to spare the reader tedious excursions into philosophy, but I cannot refrain from drawing the reader's attention to Heidegger's description of human existence as a thrownness into being. So Lukács refers to Heidegger only in order to criticize him, because Heidegger is an idealistic philosopher. So Lukács says that Heidegger's philosophy is very appropriate, or could even be the underlying thought behind modernistic writing, because Heidegger spoke of man's thrownness into being, human existence as a thrownness into being, Geworfenheit ins Dasein. So this idea of thrownness suggests by accident one finds oneself in this world. A more graphic evocation of the ontological solitariness of the individual would be hard to imagine. So Heidegger's concept of the individual solitariness is ontological. Ontology means the philosophy of existence. So man exists in this world by definition as being thrown into it. This implies not merely that man is constitutionally unable to establish relationship with things or persons outside himself, but also that it is impossible to determine theoretically the origin and goal of human existence. So, if man is accidentally thrown into this world, that suggests that there cannot be any goal of human existence, because human existence is conceived as being accidental. So I think that this is the merit of Heidegger's philosophy, that it is able to detach itself both from a previous ideological philosophy of Hegel, because you know that Hegel spoke of manifestation of the world spirit, so which suggested some kind of determination outside man. Religion always posited God as the supreme meaning giver to the world, and therefore the world becomes meaningful, it has a goal, as God provides this meaning to the world. Hegel philosophically tried to replace this theology by suggesting that it is the world spirit, Zeitgeist, that tries to manifest itself through reality, through existence. So that philosophy, even though it is idealistic, that philosophy also has some kind of a determinism, some kind of a goal or meaning attached to it. Heidegger's idea of thrownness into being does away with the world spirit and all that claptrap, that is, that there could be something outside which provides meaning to human reality. And strangely, or paradoxically, we might say that both religion and Marxism are deterministic. Sorry, Marxism suggests that because man's existence is determined by social and historical reality, and therefore it is meaningful. Marxism is deterministic. It follows the dictates of historical materialism. Religion also is deterministic because it believes that man's life is dictated or sometimes even predetermined by God. Heidegger is able to detach philosophy from both these kinds of determinism when he speaks about man's existence being thrown into this world, which therefore does away with all kinds of determinism. So Lukács finds himself opposed to Heidegger, but at the same time, paradoxically, the Marxist position is aligned with that of religion because of its belief in determinism. That is why sometimes people jokingly say that Marxism is also a religion. Do you have any questions or comments to make? Man thus conceived is an ahistorical being. The fact that Heidegger does admit a form of authentic historicity in his system is not really relevant. I have shown elsewhere that Heidegger tends to belittle historicity as vulgar, and his authentic historicity is not distinguishable from ahistoricity. So it appears that in Heidegger's philosophy, historicity is not a priority. This negation of history takes two different forms in modernist literature. First, the hero is strictly confined within the limits of his own experience. There is not for him, and apparently not for his creator, any pre-existent reality beyond his own self, acting upon him or being acted upon by him. So, in modernist literature, Lukács says, we find that the entire focus is upon the hero, and as if there is no context, as if there is no history where the hero is situated. Secondly, the hero himself is without personal history. He is thrown into the world, meaninglessly, unfathomably. He does not develop through contact with the world. He neither forms nor is formed by it. The only development in this literature is the gradual revelation of the human condition. So, la condition humaine, André Malraux's phrase. Man is now what he has always been and always will be. The narrator, the examining subject, is in motion. The examined reality is static. So Lukács theorizes that there is no scope of any development for the hero in a modernistic novel. He is static because the dynamics of history, the dynamics of dialectic is missing. Only the narrator is in motion. So there is no real development. Of course, dogmas of this kind are only really viable in philosophical abstraction, and then only with a measure of sophistry. You see, this underlying thought of modernistic literature is being termed dogma by Lukács. From a Marxist point of view, a dogma is a blind opinion, an opinion which one does not question. Therefore, Lukács says that such dogma are associated with philosophical abstraction and sophistry. So these are all negative terms that Lukács uses. Sophistry suggests some kind of cheating, some kind of deception by means of speech. The word comes from the Greek word sophist. The sophists in Greek society, they were rhetoricians, and they could argue both for and against any topic, and therefore people did not believe in them, and by association people thought that rhetoric was a lie. So sophistry has a negative connotation. A gifted writer, however extreme his theoretical modernism, will in practice have to compromise with the demands of historicity and of social environment. So here comes Lukács' comment on Joyce and Musil and Kafka. He says that a writer who is really talented, he will have to compromise with historicity and social environment. That is, he cannot totally neglect historicity. Joyce uses Dublin, Kafka and Musil, the Habsburg monarchy, as the locus of their masterpieces. But do not imagine that Lukács is praising Joyce, Kafka and Musil here. He is out to blame them. He says that they only use the historical context, but they do not probe deeply into it. So only it is only the locus of their work, but the locus they lovingly depict is little more than a backdrop. It is not basic to their artistic intention. So here again comes the argument of intention. What is the aesthetic ambition of the writer? What does he want to achieve? Does he want to depict the reality of the socio-historical context? Lukács' answer is that no. Joyce, Kafka and Musil, they do not want to depict the reality. They do not want to probe into the socio-historical context, unlike Scott and other earlier writers of historical novels. They are only using it as a backlog. That is, the details of reality provided in their novels, they are superficial, because they are not basic to the artistic ambition of these writers. This view of human existence has specific literary consequences, particularly in one category of primary theoretical and practical importance, to which we must now give our attention, that of potentiality. Now, potentiality is a term which we find in Aristotle, but Lukács is not using the Aristotelian notion of potentiality. I have written here. Lukács speaks of potentiality in Hegel, abstract and real potentiality. He does not speak of Aristotle or Aristotelian idea of potentiality. Philosophy distinguishes between abstract and concrete, which Hegel calls real potentiality. These two categories, their interrelation and opposition, are rooted in life itself. Potentiality, seen abstractly or subjectively, is richer than actual life. Innumerable possibilities for man's development are imaginable, only a small percentage of which will be realized. Modern subjectivism, taking these imagined possibilities for actual complexity of life, oscillates between melancholy and fascination. So what Lukács tries to say here, that the reality that we find described in, say, James Joyce or Kafka, like Ulysses, the castle, Musil's The Man Without Qualities, that reality is one possible realization of potentiality. This realization may be richer than actual life. So Lukács' criticism is that Joyce, Kafka or Musil, they are trying to create a real world which is richer than actual life, which means that this real world is a product of imagination. And there could be many other potentialities or many other possibilities for the world to be depicted, but these authors choose only one of them. And they confuse this imagined reality with actual reality. Take modern subjectivism, taking the imagined possibilities for actual complexity of life, oscillates between melancholy and fascination. So, Lukács won't give any credit to Joyce, Kafka or Muzi for whatever realistic description or depiction they give of Dublin or the Habsburg monarchy and so on. Because Lukács does not think that they are honest here, that it is their honest ambition to represent this reality. So, Lukács thinks that they are creating a very rich environment which they are depicting, but that is only one of the possible imagined realities or potentialities. And they confuse, the modernist writers are confusing the imagined possibilities with the real complex life. Is it clear?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And their attitude to this so-called reality is one of either melancholy or fascination. When the world declines to realize these possibilities, this melancholy becomes tinged with contempt. Hofmannsthal's Zobeide expressed the reaction of the generation first exposed to this experience. Lukács is referring to a German poet, Hugo von Hofmannsthal, and his play, The Hochzeit von Zobeide. The date is 1899. So you see, as early as 1899, Lukács finds the development of this kind of writing where there is a melancholic realization of potentialities of life. The burden of those endlessly poured over and now forever perished possibilities. So in Hofmannsthal itself, Lukács finds this melancholy which is so much to be found in the modernistic writers like Joyce, Kafka and Muzi. How far were those possibilities even concrete or real? Plainly they existed only in the imagination of the subject as dreams or daydreams. Faulkner, in whose work this subjective potentiality plays an important part, was evidently aware that reality must thereby be subjectivized and made to appear arbitrary. So the whole intention of Lukács here is to suggest that these authors, they impose their subjectivity upon reality and they do not describe what is actually out there. They do not describe reality in terms of social historical context. They represent something as reality which is the product of the imagination of a particular individual or subject. Consider this comment of his. They were all talking simultaneously, getting flushed and excited, whirling, making the unreal into a possibility, then into a probability, then into an irrefutable fact, as human beings do when they put their wishes into words. So this quotation from Faulkner, it suggests that what man imagines to be real is often a make-believe. So by degrees he achieves this make-believe. First he thinks of it as a possibility, then a probability, and then he thinks that it is an irrefutable fact. In practice, their number will border on the infinite, even with the most unimaginative individual. The possibilities in a man's mind the particular pattern, intensity and suggestiveness they assume will be, of course, characteristic of that individual, and their number will border the infinite. It is thus a hopeless undertaking to define the contours of individuality, let alone to come to grips with a man's actual fate by means of potentiality. So what is Lukács' point here? His point is that since there is an infinite number of individuals, therefore if we are to think that each of these individuals can imagine a great number of possibilities, and then the number of individuals in the world are also infinite, so how large will be the number of possibilities or imagined possibilities in the minds of all the individuals? And that can never be represented truthfully as reality. So one cannot undertake to define the contours of individuality, let alone to come to grips with man's actual fate by means of potentiality. So his criticism is that the very approach to reality should not be through potentiality. The abstract character of potentiality is clear from the fact that it cannot determine development, subjective mental states. However, permanent or profound cannot here be decisive. So, his point here is that since these modernist authors, they build their depiction of reality on potentiality, and this reality is more imagined reality or subjectivized reality, therefore there cannot be any sense of development here, because subjective mental states, they cannot be decisive. You cannot make any judgment of the world depending upon the subjective assessment of one individual. Rather, the development of personality is determined by inherited gifts and qualities, by the factors external or internal which further or inhibit their growth. It is otherwise. The individual consciousnesses cannot determine reality. On the other hand, individual personalities are developed or determined by social historical context. But in life, potentiality can of course become reality. Situations arise in which a man is confronted with a choice, and in the act of choice, a man's character may reveal itself in a light that surprises even himself. In literature, and particularly in dramatic literature, the denouement often consists in the realization of just such a potentiality, of just such a potentiality which circumstances have kept from coming to the fore. These potentialities are then real or concrete potentialities. So Lukács says that in drama particularly we find that one of the potentialities suddenly is realized. Whenever an individual is confronted with choice, he chooses one over the other. So one of the potentialities develop into reality, and even the character may be surprised that this potentiality would become real. And therefore, this leads to a dramatic surprise, which we find toward the end of a play, denouement, a resolution of the plot. Then we realize that something that we did not expect, that comes to be true. The fate of the character depends upon the potentiality in question, even if it should condemn him to a tragic end. In advance, while still a subjective potentiality in the character's mind, there is no way of distinguishing it from the innumerable abstract potentialities in his mind. So think of any play, for example, let us think of Macbeth. Whether Macbeth would yield to the suggestions of the evil suggestion in his mind about killing Duncan. He does not know. The readers, they also do not know. Because from the beginning of the play, Macbeth has been represented as a brave soldier, as loyal to Duncan. So, when he makes that choice, that yes, he will become the king by killing Duncan, then he surprises the readers as well as he surprises himself. So one of the potentialities becomes reality and it condemns him to a tragic end. But it is not possible for anybody to predict which of the subjective potentialities in a character's mind will come to be real. It may even be buried away so completely that before the moment of decision, it has never entered his mind, even as an abstract potentiality. The subject, after taking his decision, may be unconscious of his own motives. Thus, Richard Dudgeon, Shaw's devil's disciple, having sacrificed himself as Anderson, confesses, "I have often asked myself for the motive, but I find no good reason to explain why I acted as I did." So because Shaw comes much later than Shakespeare, it is much easier to take an example from a later dramatist. Because Shaw shows this complexity of the character, that the character himself is confused and says that, "I do not know why I decided or acted in this manner." Yet it is a decision which has altered the direction of his life. Of course, this is an extreme case, but the qualitative leap of the denouement, cancelling and at the same time renewing the continuity of individual consciousness, can never be predicted. The concrete potentiality cannot be isolated from the myriad abstract potentialities. Notice that Lukács here is repeatedly making this distinction between concrete potentiality and abstract potentialities. So I do not know the basis of this distinction. Maybe he thinks that some of these potentialities are so abstract that they will perhaps never become real. And those of the potentialities which are concrete, they can become real. But it is not possible for anybody to distinguish beforehand which of the potentialities are concrete and which are abstract. Only actual decision reveals the distinction. That is, actual means when somebody is acting in the present. So when the character takes this decision, then it becomes clear that this potentiality was concrete. It could be realized, and all other potentialities were abstract. The literature of realism, aiming at a truthful reflection of reality, must demonstrate both the concrete and abstract potentialities of human beings in extreme situations of this kind. So here is Lukács' dictum, that realism must demonstrate all these potentialities because they constitute the extreme situation in man's life. So we'll stop here today. Do you have any questions?